Good morning, everybody. You're now listening to the Morning Buzz here at 90.3 WMSC. Upper Montclair, we've been experiencing some very intense technical difficulties this morning, but it's okay. We made it. We're here. We're fine. Who am I, you ask? I'm your host, Lara Ziccardi, joined with me by my co-host, Amanda Gaudiosi, and our newscaster, Ashley Ramos. So without further ado, but we have a news update. That's crazy. We have news. We got a lot we're going to talk about. But before we get to that, we have a very cool news update. So Ashley, can you hear us on the other side of the room?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah.
And good morning. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ashley, and I'm joining you on this Wednesday morning from 90.3 WMSC Upper Montclair. In Montclair news, the Montclair African American Heritage Foundation Festival recognized the achievements of Black residents of Montclair Saturday, honoring those who have given back to the community. The festival took place at the TD Bank parking lot at 233 Bloomfield Ave instead of its usual location, Nishan Park. This festival's honoree list included Tom Robinson, founder of the Nostalgic Automobile Society, Marsha Walker, a founder of the Hollow Cadets Drill Team, and longtime Montclair NAACP president and foundation leader Albert Pelham. And the grand marshals were Lorena Tyson, a Montclair school teacher of 26 years, and Jay Johnson, former Secretary of Homeland Security under President Barack Obama and resident of Montclair. In New Jersey news, two men from Clifton and Patterson were hospitalized after being shot Monday night, authorities confirmed. The 19-year-old Clifton resident and under victim, 24, were wounded at the corner of Wabash and Crooks Avenues in Patterson around 8:45 p.m. Passaic County Prosecutor Camilla M. Valdez and Patterson Police Chief Abraham Baycora said. Both arrived at St. Joseph's University Medical Center via private vehicle soon after. They said Valdez and Becora didn't say whether any possible suspects have been arrested or identified. Rather, they said the investigation remains active and going on. In national news, Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo conceded Tuesday that there is not much more the White House can do to tackle record high gas prices for the Americans, casting blame on Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Unfortunately, that is a brutal reality, Raimondo said in response to CNN's Kate Bolden, saying that there's not much action left that the President Joe Biden can take. She continued, you know, this is in large part caused by Russian President Vladimir Putin's aggression. You know, since Putin moved troops to the border of Ukraine, gas prices have gone up over $1.40 a gallon. And the President is asking Congress and others for potential ideas. But as you say, the reality is that there isn't very much more to be done. In international news, Russia on Tuesday claims to have taken control of 97% of one of the two provinces that make up Ukraine's Donbas, bringing the Kremlin closer to its goal of fully capturing the eastern industrial heartland of coal mines and factories. Russian Defense Minister Sergei Shoigu said Moscow's forces hold nearly all of Luhansk province, and it appears that Russia now occupies roughly half of Donetsk province, according to Ukrainian officials and military analysis. After abandoning its bungled attempt to storm Kiev 2 months ago, Russia declared that taking the entire Donbas is its main objective. And also, for some weather, it is currently 75 degrees with passing clouds, but mostly sunny. Today, there will be a high of 86 and a low of 69. Tomorrow is looking like there will be scattered thunderstorms in the morning, but then later at night, it will clear up. This Wednesday, there will be some rain showers with a high of 71, but the weather will drop, so make sure you have a sweater on you. Thank you, and back to you, Laura.
Thank you. That was your wonderful news update. Now, personally, I found a newfound love for writing a sportscast. And I have the absolute pleasure of reporting that to you today. So here's to sports! In baseball news, yesterday, the Yankees took on the Minnesota Twins and won 10-4. This leaves the Yankees standing with 40 wins and 15 losses. But not only do we have good news for the Yankee fans out there, we also have great news for the Mets fans. The Mets played the San Diego Padres and won 7-0. This leaves the Mets standing, see what I did there, at 38 wins and 20 losses. So today the Yankees are playing the Twins again at 7:40, and the Mets are playing the Angels at 9:40. In basketball news, the Warriors and the Celtics take on each other at 9 p.m. for Game 3 of the NBA Finals. Both teams are tied, with the Celtics winning the first game and the Warriors winning the second. Moving on to hockey news, the New York Rangers played Game 4 of the NHL Conference Finals against Tampa Bay Lightning and unfortunately lost 1-4. This leaves both teams standing tied 2-2. The game 5 is set to play tomorrow at 8 p.m., and that has been your absolutely lovely sportscast that I had a lot of fun writing this morning. Like, I didn't know that I could enjoy sports, to be honest with you. But with that being said, enough about sports. We have some actual news to get into. So the Senate negotiators are racing to finalize an agreement on a narrow set of gun control proposals before the end of the week. Members of the bipartisan group of senators on Tuesday shuttled between negotiations, party briefings, and White House conversations under intense political pressure to get a deal. Negotiators have narrowed their talks to a slim set of proposals to address school safety and set standards for safe gun storage. I'm a little tongue-tied this morning, I'll be honest. Along with providing some federal support for mental health programs and the so-called red flag laws to remove guns to potentially dangerous owners. The talks also include some possible expansions to federal background checks for the younger people seeking to buy guns. The talk played out behind closed doors on Capitol Hill, while families and victims of gun violence testified in public hearings about the damage guns that wrecked on their lives. Garnell Whitefield Jr., the son of Ruth Whitefield, who was killed by a gunman last month in the mass shooting at Buffalo, NY, was among family members who began a two-day stretch of testimony and appearances on Capitol Hill. As lawmakers talked, he pleaded for them to do more than just stand by gun violence, right? It just ruins lives. Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut said there is more support among members for raising the legal age of purchasing a semi-automatic weapons to 21, though he is sober-minded about the challenges of reaching the bipartisan deal. Let's be honest, I don't think that raising the age to buy a gun is going to stop this problem. It is what it is.
Yeah, no, probably not.
Just because I would be 3 years older doesn't mean I'm still mentally stable.
Yeah, no. I mean, I saw a TikTok the other day actually about this. I don't know if you saw it, but there are these people at this rally or protest or something, and they were talking about how is it that you could legally drink at the age of 21, but you could purchase a gun at 18 years old doesn't really make sense. So I mean, if they're gonna raise the age, I guess that's better in a sense, but I also don't think we should be able to easily purchase these guns anyway. So
I gotta say, a lot of right-winged people, like people that identify as the right wing, really get worked up that the left wants to take our guns away and X, Y, and Z. But they don't understand that having these weapons are killing the innocent lives of children, adults, and even more people. And I really don't understand how they can't wrap their head around innocent people are dying. And if I'll be honest, I've seen more mass shootings happen within the last year than probably ever. And it's really sad that they're like, oh, you can't take away our Second Amendment. First of all, the Second Amendment is outdated, okay? I said it. When was this country formed? 250-something years ago? I don't know. I can't do math. This is why I'm a comm major. But you're taking an amendment from the 18th century and you're applying it to our current 21st century. It's a little outdated, if you ask me. Not only that, back then, women weren't allowed to vote. People of color weren't allowed to vote. Basically, anybody but white men were not allowed to have rights. So why are we still why are people still praising the Second Amendment almost? I really just don't understand.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, it's hard because I completely see your point 100%, and I'm definitely not for guns whatsoever. I'm just saying this right now. I just think the issue is how are they supposed to get rid of every single gun that is already out there? That's my concern, because there's already so many guns in this country, in the world. I mean, there's more guns than there are people. So
that right there, that what you said right there is so, when you put it that way and put it in that perspective, it's honestly unbelievable.
Mm-hmm.
It's sad. It really saddens me to think that there's more guns than people in this world. And yeah, back to what I was saying about the Second Amendment, back then, they did not have the technology and the machinery we have now.
Oh, yeah.
And really, I still don't get it, but I'm glad there's something being done about this.
Mm-hmm,
like,
yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I sound like I'm complaining, which, not really. I don't really know what I'm doing. I'm upset that, yes, I'm glad they're doing something, but I'm upset that it's not enough.
Mm-hmm.
But at this point, I really feel like it's a double-ended sword. Like you said, there's so many guns in this world. How are we going to regulate them?
Mm-hmm. I feel like there's no way to get rid of all of them. And also, there's going to be people who aren't even going to give up all their guns. There's people who illegally have guns now. There's people who have them not registered, hiding in their houses. Like, how are we gonna know whose houses to go to, what guns to take? It's just, it stinks that it's like this, and it's really sad. I wish it wasn't like this, but I mean, like you said, at least they're doing something, raising the age. I think what they need to do is, what did it say right here? It said something that I was like, oh, this is good, I want to read this.
Mm-hmm.
I can't find it now. Oh, okay. The background checks. I mean, I think that's good. If you're going to actually do background checks for people who are younger trying to purchase guns, I mean, I think that's a good thing, obviously. But the other issue is with that is someone could have a perfectly clean record and still be crazy.
That's so, exactly what I was going to say.
So how are you supposed to know? Like, I'm pretty sure the gunman at the Uvalde school was completely fine, had a perfect record, and then went to the school. So I'm not sure how they're supposed to know. You could have a clean record and then purchase a gun, and
That's the unfortunate thing. You're never gonna know. You're never gonna know. But again, glad something's being done. But with that being said, we have to move on.
Yes.
We have more news for you.
All right. Yeah. So Montclair threatens Ascend, a recreational marijuana shop, and the sales are being halted. A few people were lined up on Bloomfield Avenue outside Ascend on Tuesday as the medical marijuana dispensary opened its doors at 10 a.m. to its first recreational customers without municipal approval. Caitlin Fleischman, Ascend's Director of Public Affairs, said by 1:15 p.m. that sales stopped after Paul Burr, the interim Montclair Township attorney, notified Ascend, saying if they don't stop recreational sales, the township would send code enforcement and police. Ascend had received both state and local approval to expand to recreational sales at its Rochelle Park dispensary in April, but Ascend representatives said that they were tired of Montclair, quote, dragging its feet on its licensing for its location on Bloomfield Avenue. Representatives of the company said Ascend's attorney had notified the township on March 27th and again on June 6th that the business intended to open for recreational sales this week. But Montclair's August 2021 ordinance permitting and regulating the sale of recreational marijuana within the township's borders also requires a business to complete an application, quote, on a standardized form established by the township council and available in the office of the township clerk. During business hours Monday, no such application had yet been posted to the township's website. The application was still under review by the township manager in the afternoon. It ultimately didn't appear on the website until 7:46 p.m., with another delay being caused by, quote, issues with our content management system yesterday afternoon. The township was unable to post the update until hours after work, once its vendor resolved the issue. when no application had yet been posted by 7:30 p.m. on Monday for a send to fill out, the faculty continued planning to open up recreational sales at 10 a.m. on Tuesday. Ascend Montclair's website began taking appointments for recreational orders beginning Tuesday. Fleischman said Monday night that the interim township attorney told Ascend it would be unlawful for Ascend to open up recreational sales on Tuesday. That was a mouthful. Dude, I'm so sorry.
I was going to say, that you killed it though. I'm sorry, that was a lot. I was honestly reading this article yesterday and I went, there's so much information in here that is really important that I can't leave out because, oh my God, I just want to say this is quite messy.
Mm-hmm.
Not only is I was analyzing this because for context, I used to be a public relations major and I find how companies deal with scandals. This isn't a scandal, but it's a problem. Deal with issues publicly is so interesting to me because what you say is like, it matters so much what you say and how you say it in the PR world. It's just so fascinating, but it's so, let's just say, not only I feel like is Ascend kind of in the wrong, but also like the town's kind of in the wrong. Am I in the wrong? For those of you who don't know what Am I in the Wrong is, it is a segment that we do during the fall and spring semesters of the Morning Buzz when we have 2 hours. We unfortunately can't do it today because we have a lot of news to cover. But am I in the wrong? We basically read a story and we discuss if the person who wrote the story is in the wrong. And I gotta say, this is a case where everybody's in the wrong, because not only did really Montclair get to publish the application, but Ascend really just said, oh, we're just gonna start selling it anyway. Makes sense. Not only that, I feel like they had like a fair warning from the township attorney that was like, that's unfair. It'll be unfair if you start selling it recreationally on Tuesday, but they did it anyway. I have no words.
Yeah, while I was reading it, I had no idea what I was talking about, to be honest. There was a lot on the page. So I was like, I'm just going to read and hope for the best. But now that you're explaining it, that makes a lot more sense. Yeah. So I understand where the problem is now. Because as I was reading it, I was like, I'm so confused. But now I understand. And
Yeah,
how are they supposed to do that? I mean, if the town is saying you can't sell yet, and then they just decide to sell, wouldn't that be like illegal? Isn't that like... wrong?
Yeah, that's literally what I think it is. The township attorney notified the company and said, if you don't stop the recreational sales, the township will send a code enforcement and the police. So yes, very much illegal. But I gotta say is, maybe I feel like someone was procrastinating on that application.
Oh yeah, for sure.
To be fair, we're all guilty of doing it, but because that happened, we got this lovely, lovely story. But with that being said, we're going to take a very short break here on the Morning Buzz. Please stay tuned because we're going to be talking about one of our favorite topics, gas. Wow, fascinating. Because gas is how much now? You'll have to stay tuned.
You want to feel important.
You want to be
deserve. So me and my roommate and I have a joke because my roommate is also the digital marketing director here at the station. And basically, we are located in Upper Montclair. If you haven't known, if you forget what you're listening to, you're listening to 90.3 WMSC Upper Montclair. And basically, our inside joke is that we say Upper Montclair in the most bizarre way possible. So we'll just go, Upper Montclair. Yeah, that's the joke. But anyway, we're not talking about Upper Montclair. We're going to be talking about gas prices because NJ gas prices top $5 a gallon. You heard that right. $5 a gallon. I'll say it one more time if that didn't resonate with you. $5 a gallon. The first time as summer travel starts to begin. Ah, yes, the pain at the pump has hit a new milestone here in New Jersey. On Tuesday, the average price for a gallon of regular gasoline has crept past $5 at a $5 gallon. I'm sorry, I'm still in shock. It crept past $5 a gallon in the state for the first time. To put this into perspective, a gallon of gas costs $4.75 a week ago, $4.42 a month ago, and $3.06 by this time last year. The price spikes come as a global crude oil trades at about $118 a barrel, with no sign of slowing down for the summer travel season, which has seen Americans consider rethinking their travel plans, because honestly, I'm rethinking my plans. A spokesperson from the American Automobile, I'm not going to say that again, the association, aka AAA, or as I would call it from now on, A squared, no, A cubed, I can do math, I promise. Andrew Gross said, quote, at some point, drivers may change their daily driving habits or lifestyle due to these high prices, but we're not there yet. According to A Cubed, the spike has been fueled in a part by increased demand from summer travel. Tuesday's figures beat a previous state record from Monday. New Jersey's gas prices hit their last major spike in September of 2013, when they were just $3.88 a gallon, which equals about $4.90 after adjusting for inflation. So if you're wondering, wow, counties have different prices, don't they? Well, they do. Bergen County's average gas price was about $5.01 as of Tuesday versus $4.99 in Passaic, $4.97 in Sussex, $5.06 in Essex, and $5.05 in Morris County. And for our shore listeners out there, it was $5.03 in Monmouth County and $5.02 in Ocean County. I'll be honest, I really need to address the quote from the spokesperson that I'll read it again for you. He said, quote, at some point, drivers may change their daily driving habits or lifestyle due to these high prices, but we're not there yet. You mean we haven't been there? Because personally, in my humble opinion, I think we've been there, to be honest.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, I feel like this is getting outrageous. Like, when I first started driving 5 years ago at this point, I never really paid attention to the gas prices. I didn't ever really know to look. I just kind of, oh, okay, I'll pay for it. Because it was like $3 a gallon, wasn't a big deal. Now, $5 a gallon, it's like that's almost as much as some people get paid minimum wage, because the average minimum wage is $7 in America. So I don't understand how we're expected to pay this much money for a gallon of gas. How are we supposed to go places? It's scary. I mean, exactly. You can't. Me and my boyfriend have been riding our bikes everywhere because
that is smart.
Yeah, because gas is so expensive, and honestly, get a good workout too. We've just been riding our bikes everywhere, especially when we go down the shore, ride your bike everywhere, because $5.05 and $5.03 is absolutely nuts for gas, and I don't know how we're expected to pay that much for a gallon.
I'm still speechless, because I'll be honest, unlike you, you weren't that aware of gas mm-hmm. prices when you started driving, but I was, because I have a Capricorn Mercury, and if that doesn't mean anything to you guys, or if you don't understand that, basically Mercury rules communication and finances and all that fun stuff, so that's just the way your brain is wired, and mine is in Capricorn, which is an earth sign, which is really kind of logical, and I just money. I'm very like frugal with my money. Like I decide to spend it very wisely, but I've gotten Starbucks for the third time this week, but it's fine. But I was always aware of gas prices. And I remember about, 3 years ago, I was a senior in high school. This was right before COVID. And I got to fill my gas tank for $20. And
I miss that. I do too, man.
Because, like, I'll be honest, I am way too young to feel this old. Because what I feel like I've aged at least 8 years by the time COVID has happened. And I'm like, man, these gas prices are really, really going up these days. $5 a gallon? I have no, I still have no words. It like kind of infuriates me, to be honest.
No, I totally agree with you. I remember just even a couple months ago, I think like October, November, I remember seeing a sign and it was like $3.33 for gas. And I was like, okay, that's a lot. That's kind of crazy. Yeah. Now we're at $5 a gallon. That's absolutely nuts. I don't even know how some people have really big cars and really big gas tanks and it's like $100 to fill each time. Like that's not even worth it, I feel like, to drive. Just walk everywhere at this point because it's like, how are you supposed to pay that much money, especially when we're not getting paid that much?
You expect us to pay these gas prices and you're not paying us enough. Make it make sense. But before we're going to wrap it up, my grandpa drives a Suburban, which is a Chevy, like a big, big car. And speaking of my grandpa, happy birthday. It's my grandpa's birthday today.
Oh, happy birthday.
But yeah, I can't imagine how much it would cost to fill a large car like that. Like that's a big car. And I no words. I'm thankful I drive a sedan because I if I'm lucky, I'll get $40 a gallon for three quarters. But the people who have the SUVs and the big cars, I feel for you. But with that being said, we have more news.
Yes, we are going to talk about the New Jersey primaries. So here are the unofficial results of the New Jersey primary elections in the Garden States on Tuesday. The votes will determine which candidates will represent their political party in the November general election for seats in the U.S. House of Representatives. Brand name Republicans fended off challenges from the right, while all 10 Democratic incumbents won their contests. Awesome. This sets the stage for a midterm fight over control of the House of Representatives. The results of November's general election in New Jersey could have a ripple effect in Washington, D.C. At least one congressional district is widely considered likely to flip to Republican control, and others in North Jersey could become competitive with inflation, high gas prices, and low approval ratings for Democratic President Joe Biden. In those North Jersey districts, Democratic reps Josh Gottheimer of Wyckoff and Mickey Sherrill of Montclair faced no challengers Tuesday, but votes for which Republican candidate will face them were still being counted late into the night Tuesday. Other notable victories include those of Chris Smith, the 42-year veteran representing the 4th District, and Tom Keene Jr., the former state lawmaker who claimed the nomination in a field of 7 Republicans running in the 7th District. The one analyst says it's most likely to flip. Republicans hold 2 of the state's 12 congressional seats. And Rob Menendez Jr.'s victory over Democratic challengers all but assures he will serve in the Capitol alongside his father, U.S. Senator Bob Menendez. The 8th District, the younger Menendez, is running to represent its heavily Democratic and includes some of the largest cities in the state, including Elizabeth and parts of Newark and Jersey City, while the Republican nominee is Marcos Arroyo.
Yo, I'll be honest. When I was writing the story this morning, because I waited this morning to get the most recent news on the primary, and I'll be 110% honest with you, I had no idea what I was doing, but I did my best. I mean, there's really nothing much to say about primaries. Voting is cool. I forgot to vote for the primary, but I'll be honest with you, I was really thinking just now, actually, no, I'm still thinking just now. Let's use that in the present tense. It's so fascinating that we have to vote for someone to vote for someone to vote for someone in this country.
Yeah.
Is that weird? Like, honestly, I would love to know how this, I would love to know the ins and outs of how this government works. Well, it doesn't really work. It's just tolerated. Oops. That's just my humble opinion. But I really, it's confusing because, you know, they don't really teach us how the voting works. They just go, voting's cool. Because I remember seeing a TikTok and it was, oh, your vote for the presidential election doesn't really necessarily count. Because the way that it was founded is that it doesn't really count each individual's vote. It counts for the location, as I want to say. It's just really, it's really fascinating. All I gotta say, the voting in this country is a little outdated. You know, just like the Second Amendment. Oops, we're gonna move on. Sorry, I had to do it. But we're gonna move on to a very short break here on the Morning Buzz. Now, what we have up next, you better stay tuned because this woman lost her iPhone on an island. Did it ever come back? I guess we'll have to find out. But for those of you who forget, it is Pride Month, and I promise that I will be playing some LGBTQ artists. And now we have the one and only Lil Nas X, because he's the icon we need in 2022. We are not going to be mentioning computers here on the bus because we're going to be talking about a Mississippi island. That's right. Before I accuse that a woman lost her phone on an island. Turns out it's in Mississippi. But I want to address the real problem. Did any of you know that Mississippi had an island? Because I didn't. But
I did not.
I didn't either, man. But a Mississippi coast woman saw what she called the good side of Facebook in action this week after a Good Samaritan found a phone she lost during a Memorial Day trip to Horn Island. For those of you who don't know, like myself, Horn Island is a popular boating destination off the Mississippi coast near Ocean Springs and some other town in Mississippi. I don't know. So Erin Skaggs of Gulfport was on the island last Monday when her iPhone disappeared. She said on Sunday on Facebook, quote, "I assumed it was a lost cause, dot, dot, dot. I got a new phone on Tuesday." 6 days later, however, a man was out on Horn Island and found the phone underwater and decided to see if it still worked. Cody Lowe shared a photo of the home's lock screen, which features a photo of her and her husband on Facebook, and it was shared 100 times. I'm sorry, not 100 times, hundreds of times. Skaggs said, quote, "He plugged it in and it turned on at 5:03 p.m. And around a half hour later, the phone was back in her possession. The fact that the iPhone that Lowe found was still operational was actually really surprising, especially to me, because one time my iPod Touch got a little wet and it didn't turn on. But I digress. For those of you who don't know, all Apple iPhones past the iPhone 7 model are water resistant, but most only last after being submerged for about 30 minutes. Her phone was on the island for a week. Cool. I guess, I don't know, man. I don't, like, honestly, the luck, the sheer luck, because personally, if my phone dropped on an island, it would probably die. Like, it would be gone. Like, she'd be a lost cause.
Same. Yeah, I mean, that's honestly fascinating, because I have dropped my phone in, like, little puddles of water, like, not even a lot of water, and then the speakers will be shot. So I'm like, okay.
Cool. All right.
That's awesome. So if hers was underwater under a week, word. What is she going to do with the new phone now, though? She bought a new one.
I don't know, man. What would you do with it?
She has two phones now.
I'd honestly sell the old one.
True. Well, no, I would keep that, though, because that's like, it was underwater, so it's like,
oh, I think Apple has that thing where, like, you sell back your phone or something.
Oh yeah, that's like the new thing where you could, like, sell your phone back and get a new upgrade, I think. I'm not sure. All of my phones have never been able to be upgraded because they have been either broken or lost completely. Like my last phone, I accidentally dropped it off the side of a mountain.
Okay. Speaking of mountains. Speaking of mountains, we have another story that is from New York State. Upstate New York. Woo!
All right.
I tried with that transition. I'm sorry. I tried.
Oh, no, then that was fantastic.
Thank you.
All right. So on Tuesday, a courthouse in upstate New York was closed for fumigation after hundreds of cockroaches were released during an altercation that broke out after arraignment. The clash broke out during proceedings in Albany City Court for four people for an arrest at the state capitol. A defendant who started to film the courtroom proceedings were told to stop. In the altercation that followed, hundreds of cockroaches brought into the courthouse in plastic containers were released, according to the state court system. The bug release was being investigated while the courthouse was closed for the rest of the day for fumigation. Court officers arrested a 34-year-old woman in the audience for charges related to the altercation, including disorderly conduct, obstructing governmental administration, and tampering with physical evidence. She was released, and it was not immediately clear whether she had an attorney to speak on her behalf.
Okay, before we get to the roaches, I have a question. Amanda, what mountain did you drop your phone off of?
It's called Mount Tammany. I don't know if you've ever heard of it.
I'm gonna look it up.
It's kind of it's really big. It's in PA a little bit.
Oh.
Yeah, I live in a part of Jersey that's near PA, so I was like, yeah, I was like, let's go on a nice hike. I was on my phone with my friends. Well, no, we were hiking up to the top and I went on my phone to take videos with my friends. And as I was on the edge of the mountain, I had an iPhone 11, so it was really slippery. And I only had the phone for less than a year at this point, and it just slipped out of my hands. And me and my friends just watched it boom, 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 fall down the mountain. I was just staring at it like,
call the iPhone 11 Bon Jovi because it'd be slippery when wet.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to the roaches.
Yes.
I don't know if you saw any roaches on your hike though.
I did not.
That's such a shame. I the only time I've really seen a roach in person was in my high school.
Ooh.
Yeah, I really don't know why it. I really don't know. We're located in Wayne, New Jersey, and there's just roaches, and there's like little mice too.
Okay.
I went to a really big high school. Like, if you're gonna have a really big high school, take care of it.
Mm-hmm.
PSA. If you have a big high school, take care of it. But that's just me. The way she was charged with disorderly conduct, obstructing governmental administration, and tampering with physical evidence during, I just want to know what made her go, yes, I'm going to bring my pet roaches. I don't even know if they're pets, to be honest. What made her think, yes, I'm going to bring roaches to court?
Yeah, that's what's so funny about this to me. It's like, well, where did she get all of them is my question. There's hundreds of them just running around.
Like, okay, is this woman the Bronx Zoo? Like, did she just steal them from the Bronx Zoo? Because, like, for those of you who don't know, at the Bronx Zoo, there's this roach exhibit where there's a cutout in the floor, and then there's glass on top of it, and there's a bunch of roaches, and I think it's the whole wall too. Anyway, no thank you for me. I'm good.
Same here. I don't like beetle type bugs, roaches.
I don't do bugs.
No.
I don't do bugs. And I wanted to tell the story on air when we started out, but I didn't want to like outright say, oh, bug story while we got to air. So I saved it. I remembered I had this story. I'm like, oh, I'm going to save my bug story from this morning. So I walked downstairs with my little tote bag and I put it down on the floor, whatever. I grab my water bottle. I dump out some extra water in the sink, as someone does. And the biggest centipede crawled out of the sink and I literally wanted to pass away. But like it couldn't get out of the sink because it was slippery. So like it was just like it kept crawling up and it just kept going back down. But since I am a chicken and I don't do bugs, I texted a photo of it to my dad. And I said, when you wake up, can you please kill it? And he texted me before the show started, like right before the show started. And he said, done. So
amazing.
The centipede is dead. But yeah, I don't do bugs.
I also don't do bugs. And it's where I live. There's a lot of bugs, too. Like in my house, when people come over, they'll be like, oh, there's like a spider. I'm like, yeah, they're just here. It's very annoying.
Are you in Warren County?
Yes.
Where
indeed.
In Warren County?
Like the Blairstown area. Warren County. Yeah. And there's always just bugs. And I remember this one time I was in the basement with my brother and there was this huge spider. And I was like, ew, like step on it. I don't like spiders. He proceeds to step on the spider and thousands, I'm not even exaggerating, thousands of baby spiders dispersed under his foot.
Goodbye.
Screamed. It was the scariest moment of my entire life.
Goodbye. Goodbye. I'm done. I have a story for Amanda, but it's not FCC safe. So Amanda, I will probably text you that later.
Yes, please.
But we're done talking about bugs because now we're gonna be talking about food. Great transition, right? Amazing. Anyway,
yummy.
A man in India divorced his wife for cooking him instant noodles every day for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. A judge in India said a man divorced his wife for cooking him instant noodles every day. The principal district and sessions court judge recounted the case on May 27th at a press conference at a court in the southwestern region of India. The sessions court judge told the outlet that he was a district judge when he attended and was called the Maggie case. The man in the press conference said his wife would buy packets of Maggie noodles, which is a brand of noodles, instant noodles, and served them to him for breakfast, lunch, and dinner throughout their marriage. The judge said the couple divorced with mutual consent. And for context, under India's Special Marriage Act of 1954, divorce by mutual consent requires both parties to live separately for 1 year and agree to dissolve the marriage. And of course, he did not provide information on the date of the case or the names of the couple involved. And Insider did note that they were not able to independently verify the case. Okay, we're gonna ask the critical questions here, right? Now, do you think it was just the noodles and the seasoning packet, or did she like spice it up a bit, you know?
Well, I feel like if she spiced it up a bit and like added things to it, it wouldn't have been a problem. But obviously, you know, it was probably just plain, just the little flavor packet that comes with it and the little noodles.
But like, okay, I've been kind of obsessed with ramen noodles since I was like 9. It's delicious, to be honest with you.
Yeah, how could you be mad at ramen? It's perfect. It's noodles, it's warm, it's comforting.
Stop. I'm actually going to go home and make myself some ramen noodles. But
exactly.
It looks good. Like, I'm looking on the photo of the article and like, I can really go for some ramen right now. Is it 8:52 a.m.? Yes. But will I have ramen when I go home? Probably not. I'll probably wait till 12 because I'm weird like that. I'm not going to eat breakfast. I'm not going to eat lunch. Sorry. Not going to eat lunch until it's like 12 o'clock. But I really don't know how you can be mad. Ramen is, well, okay. To be fair, it was every day, three times a day.
But he could also make his own food, though, low-key.
Right? That's what I was... You bring up a good point.
Yeah, if he's so mad about it, then he could just make his own breakfast and lunch and dinner. But
I wonder, now that he's divorced, I wonder what he's making himself now.
Probably ramen.
Oh, my God. Imagine. I would pass away. But I wonder what, like, flavor of ramen it was, too.
True, yeah, because there's flavors. I haven't really had like instant ramen before. I've only ever had like real ramen. I know that sounds like bougie of me. I'm like, I've never had the instant ramen.
I'm too fancy for the instant ramen.
I kind of want to try it though.
It's good. Like it slaps.
And it seems easy.
Yeah. Let's see. Let's see what flavors we have. Oh, we have spicy.
Of course.
We have masala. Oh, that's still spicy.
Also I think spicy?
I think it's like just spicy.
Oh, maybe it was too much for him. Maybe it was too spicy. He couldn't handle it.
Can't handle the heat.
Maybe not.
Can't handle the heat. But I wonder if he'll season it with some salt.
Salt makes everything better.
Do you think he'll season it with Himalayan salt?
Perhaps. Very good transition.
Thank you.
Because we are talking about a Himalayan salt wall. Restaurant guests are encouraged to lick the walls while dining, which I have a story that relates to this after I read this. Patrons at a restaurant in Arizona are welcome to lick the walls while they dine. The Mission restaurant is gaining attention in Old Town Scottsdale after its owners said guests could lick the walls while enjoying their food or a drink, as the walls are made of Himalayan rock salt. Representatives with the trendy dining spot said that the head chef brought the rocks in to add to the overall ambiance and help customers with their tequila shots. Himalayan rock salt has natural sanitary properties, but restaurant staff said they regularly wipe them down.
Okay, I'll be honest. I sometimes lick my Himalayan salt lamp in my room.
That was my story.
It tastes so good.
When I first got mine and I opened it up, I was like, I'm gonna lick this. It's salt, so I'm gonna try it. And it really is salty. I mean, now mine's like dusty, so I'm not gonna lick it now, but it is pretty good.
I think you should dust it and just go ham. Wait, oh my gosh, okay, I'm gonna ask another critical question. If you lick it enough, will it like dissolve? You know, start to disappear? Yeah. I need to know right now, because
probably
that's a problem with me. Like, I need to know like pretty much everything. Will I don't even know how to word it.
If you lick your Himalayan salt lamp, will it dissolve? Question mark. That okay. is the question.
If you lick your Himalayan salt lamp, will it dissolve? Okay, let's find out. Okay, it's all I'm getting is we asked people why they lick their Himalayan salt lamps. It's tasty, okay?
It's amazing. I mean, there's a restaurant doing it now, so obviously.
Okay, to be
pretty smart.
I want to be honest. I kind of want a wall of Himalayan salt.
Me too. Ever since I was a little kid, I would always do this. I just pour salt in my hand and lick it off my hand. I know that's so strange, but I always do that. I'm like obsessed with salt, which is probably not a good thing, but.
Amanda, I love you, but that's really on brand for you.
It is very on brand. I feel like my brand is wacky and weird. And why are you doing this? So
stop. That's my brand too. To be honest, like we're just. Oh wait. Oh, I just found a question on Google, and it says, "Oh, that's really sad because I thought it said, 'Can you eat a Himalayan salt lamp?' But it actually just said, 'Can you eat Himalayan salt?' And of course you can."
If you could have it in the little salt form, sorry to cut you off, but if you could have it in the little salt form, why couldn't you lick the lamp? It's just,
that's what I'm saying.
Exactly. Anyway, continue.
I'm just reading this article on webmd.com. It says, quote, "Research has not demonstrated that Himalayan salt has any unique health benefits compared to other dietary salt, but it's pretty and it's pink and I am a material girl."
Me too. Pink salt's just better.
I know. It's fun. It's almost like flaky sea salt is better.
Yeah.
Because, like, you have table salt and kosher salt, and that's, like, so normal.
It is.
And boring.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be quirky. I want to not be like the other salts. I can't believe we've been talking about this for 3 straight minutes.
Out of all of the stories we had today, I feel like this is the one I could really go in on this one, because salt is just so essential to all foods. Like, I cannot eat food if there's no salt in it.
It's just bland then.
Exactly.
How, like, to the people who don't season their food, I really don't understand how you don't season your food. Put some PSA. I would suggest putting Himalayan salt on everything.
Agreed.
Okay, but like, to be fair, what is your favorite kind of spice? That's a great question, right?
Yeah, that is a very good question, because it depends on my mood, because I kind of like cinnamon.
Oh, let's do sweet and savory.
Okay, so I think my sweet is definitely cinnamon, and then I guess like my kind of savory is like cayenne pepper. I really like spicy. Also, like, Himalayan salt is like a close second, but
Himalayan salt is, can't even be ranked, because it is top tier already. Like,
of course,
it's in its own category. But I think my favorite, I'm with you on the cinnamon with the sweet, but I think my favorite savory is probably Cajun.
Ooh,
right? Because when you go to Five Guys and you get the Cajun fries, and
yes,
they're just really tasty. I kind of want fries now.
Same.
Yeah, we're all potato lovers here. Oh, and not only that, we're gonna also put, we'll put our Himalayan salt on our fries. I don't know how good that would be, but we are salt lovers here at 90.3 WMSC, Upper Montclair. This has been the Morning Buzz. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Catch us tomorrow. Same time, same place, just different people. And that has been the Morning Live from the Hive. Anyway, tune in next time. Thank you for always starting your day with us, and we'll see you tomorrow.
You're listening to WMSC.